Okay, just a second.
This meeting is being recorded.
Yes. Okay, so let me start. Thank you for coming. So I will talk about two-way quantum computers, some enhancement, improvement over the standard approach to quantum computers. So like in this first slide, so there are some chips like microfluid chips, microfluidic chip. Chips like this one that you can control flow of fluid through it, and there are photonic chips for which can be used for photonic quantum computers. So I believe there is some similarity between them, especially that there is this analogy between electromagnetics and hydrodynamics that can be defined by very very close equations, especially for superfluids without viscosity. So let's think about this hydrodynamic setting at the beginning. So imagine that there are two outgoing pipes from such chip. So we could passively measure as observe from which pipe the fluid is flowing. So this is measurement, but you could also do actively. So instead of just watching, we could literally pull with negative pressure. Yeah, so we could apply negative pressure and influence the flow of the fluid. So this way, if you would pull with negative pressure, you would both push fluid inside this chip and pull from so for better control of the flow through this chip. So this improvement of flow is the idea I would like to use for quantum computers like photonic, that we don't have just measurement, this passive measurement, but also some active active influence over the system. So if we have a way to influence the initial state of quantum computer by state preparation, so using the same process but reverse as CPD symmetry analog, you should be able to actively influence the final state of quantum computers. So like not only pushing with laser, so here is pushing with laser as state preparation for quantum computer, but we could also use negative radiation pressure to pull from photonic quantum computer to for better flow of information inside. So if being able to do it, I'll try to convince you that we can do it. If being able to do it, we would be able to attack more difficult problems like MP problems, MP complete problems. So here is some general picture. The simplest such fluid chip as just a speed. So this is our chip, the simplest possible chip. And so we've here is a pump. So with positive pressure, we push fluid inside, and we this way it would go to our left and toward down. So usually it would go in both directions. But if you also apply the negative pressure like here, then we should reduce the flow down because of the negative pressure. So we control this simplest chip by controlling both positive pressure and negative pressure. So both push and pull from here to reduce this flow out down the split. So also for electrons, we can also, if you have a cable, a conductor, we could apply electric field and electron would flow, would just ignore the split. Yes, because we will both push and pull this electron through this conductor. So maybe we could use this analogy with electromagnetism that to do it for pairs of phonons. There are quantum computers on phonons considered mechanical qubit, and maybe for electromagnetic waves using the analogy for microwaves, and finally hopefully for photons as very practical quantum computers. So I'm trying to convince that a ring laser, so a laser which can unidirectional photon trajectory like in these arrows can really act as the pump, so it acts as a pump for photons. So why? Because so this way it creates photons in this direction as kind of positive pressure. But looking at this picture from a perspective of CPT symmetry, the direction of electrons will be reversed. So it creates, so here is this such reversed direction. So the flow of photons would go left, So instead of creating positive pressure here, it would create positive pressure here. So that means that in the original picture, it should create negative pressure here. So this unidirectional laser should act also as a kind of photon pump. I'll try to convince, I give more arguments for that later. And also looking from this perspective, then if it's symmetric, then the flow here and flow here should be the same. So all the photons should go practically through this beam splitter, ignoring it. Also, they cannot go up here because it would require a photon source here, but which is not here. So it suggests that thanks for this negative pressure, the photon should literally ignore this, the beam splitter. So this is one of experimental tests I would like to conduct, but I'm looking for a collaboration to do so. Okay, so here is very similar picture. So we have this hydrodynamical analog and electromagnetic, and so we'd like to build this kind of two-way quantum computers, which is one-way quantum computers, like standard one that we have set preparation and measure, this kind of passive behavior, just watching what's from which pipe the fluid flows. But we have additionally CPT analog state preparation, doing the same as for state preparation, but reverse as CPT symmetry analog, like pulling, negative positive radiation pressure for photons stimulated emission absorption. We'll use these equations, and they are kind of CPT symmetric, that they switch side when applying, looking from perspective of CPT symmetry. So finally, such computers, we not only have this initial state here, but also we can affect this partially the final state here. So still we have unitary evolution through the quantum gates, but we can also affect by this kind of negative pressure pulling with light to affect the final state, what will give us larger computational possibilities. Okay, so the there is very large interest in the quantum computers. It grows every year by billions of dollars, and so there are many also skeptical people, but there are claims of quantum superiority. So if being able to add this additional operation, this CPT analog of state preparation, as some addition to standard passive measure or just observe, then we should be able to go from, so here is the standard complexity diagram that we have polynomial time, so P as the solvable in polynomial time, and P means that non-deterministic polynomial, generally that there is a verifier, there is a program which can in polynomial time test if given input is right, and the question is, is there some right proper input? I will talk later. So we believe there are different, but it's not proven. This is open problem, P versus NP. And the quantum, by standard quantum computers, there are these BQP. So it is believed that they cannot work with NP problems. And then we can also go outside of the P problem. So the outside, the basic class is the P space. That means that you can solve them in polynomial space this time. So now you'd like to improve this BQP to this two-way, these enhanced quantum computers, two-way quantum computers. And I would try to convince that they should contain all the NP problems. So it should be larger than the BQP containing NP problems. So in theory, at least, they should be potentially much stronger than the standard quantum computers. The basic algorithm will be resemble Shor algorithm. And for Shor, we know that it's very difficult to get a practical implementation. So also here, it might be very, very difficult to get a practical implementation, but we can start with the quantum supremacy claims and try to improve them with this additional operation, the CPT analog of state preparation. Okay, so here is sometimes this basic, this complexity classes. So there is this polynomial, NP, that there is this verifier that in polynomial time we can check is given input is right. But the difficulty is that there are this exponential number of potential inputs. So for example, factorization can be seen as a problem here, right? This blue dot, we believe, so we don't know it's not in P, but we believe it's not in P. So this is factorization, because in polynomial time you can change, so having some big number for factorization, the question is to finding the divider of this number. So to check, so having some such candidate for the divider, it's easy to check if it is a divider, but the problem is that there are lots of possible candidates. So factorization can be seen as an NP problem, later not P problem. Yeah? So this is more difficult, but there are finally this NP complete problem. This is a family of believed to be the most difficult NP problems, and there is polynomial equivalence between them. So being able to find a polynomial time algorithm for one of them, for all of them would such algorithm exist, and proving that for that one of them is not P, we would prove it for all of them. So there is this where the most important computer science problem, P versus NP. If there are equal or not equal, and proving it for one problem, we do it for all. So, but let's focus on this, the simplest one, the Trisat problem. So the Trisat problem is, so it's, we have these alternatives of trees of variables. Some can be negated, like here, and we can, the question is, can we put them binary values 0 or 1, such that all the alternatives are true. Yes, so it looks simpler, and also for implementation. So the problem is that there are exponential number of possible inputs, and searching them is quite difficult. And we know that it's equivalent with other NP complete problems. Then there are also more difficult, believed to be more difficult problems, the p-space problems, like here that in polynomial space now we can solve them. So we just need polynomial size memory. There are p-space complete problems, for example, like Trisat, the most difficult ones, like Trisat, but with this for all quantifier. So also allowing the for all, it becomes much, much more difficult. So there are these solved by quantum computers as the standard of quantum computers, these one-way quantum computers, in polynomial time with some tolerable error probability. And so we could now discuss this the same, but for two-way quantum computers, like with this additional operation, the CPT analog state preparation. So I will argue that we can attack NP problems, but what's happening beside, we don't know. So there are lots of computational complexity questions. What exactly is it? Is it p-space? I think it's smaller than p-space, but I don't know what exactly. So, but it should go if PQP goes out of NP, so it should also go out maybe stronger, but it's open, very difficult and interesting question. Okay, so for NP problems, so the more difficult than for standard quantum computers, they can be formulated for Isaac model. So Isaac model is very similar to quantum mechanics. So in Isaac model, we assume Boltzmann ensemble among configurations. In quantum mechanics, we assume Feynman ensemble among configurations as paths in time. So mathematically, they are very similar, but somehow Ising looks stronger here because it allows for NP, while standard quantum computers don't allow. And the answer is because in standard quantum computers we treat the boundary conditions asymmetric way, that we can influence only from the past, but from the future we can only measure. So we cannot influence from the right. While for Ising, this is mounting in the left and mounting in the right. So it's easy to do for Ising. So in theory, Ising could be stronger, but in practice, it's not so easy. Yes, but there are many approaches with Ising model to end problems, but there are different problems with them. So maybe let's go further. But the superiority here, at least in theory of Ising, is that it can mount in both directions, while standard quantum computers can mount only from the left, and from the right, you can only watch. You can only passively watch what's happening. So. For two-way quantum computers, we will add this active influence for the conditions on the right. Okay, so let's look at some details. So here is the Shor algorithm of the Farr factorization. So here is general behavior. So we have some qubits for the input and for value. We start have this state preparation for zero. And then there are these Hadamard gates, and they prepare superposition of all 2 to the power n all possible inputs for our problems. And then there is a classical function, which here is this modulo, this y to power r modulo n, and n is the factorized number. And then we measure this classical function. So doing so, measuring this value, we restrict this ensemble from, instead of 2 to power n all inputs, so we get only inputs having the same randomly chosen m value for this classical function. And it turns out mathematically that it's a periodic set, and we can find this period with the Fourier transform and then measure. So what is surprising maybe that this measurement restricts the ensemble. So looking from causality perspective, it causes restriction for this branch causes restriction for this branch. So it's not very trivial. So then here is this basic two-way quantum computer for let's say Tricet problem or general non-deterministic polynomial problem. So it's the same at the beginning. We prepare this ensemble of all the inputs, then use the classical function as this verifier, which tests if this input is right or not. So for example, for Tricet, these are alternatives with nodes. So these are control ors. In practice, and then we would like to affect to influence the outputs. We would like to enforce them instead of making them random. We'd like to enforce them to one. Let's say all the alternatives in Tricet have to be true. So doing so, doing this enforcement, so not random but these are enforced ones. We have restricted the ensemble to only those satisfying our, let's say, Tricet problem. So NP problem. So now measuring, so having this such ensemble, we could just measure one, and we could get one of solutions to our problem. So having these stronger quantum computers, these two-way quantum computers, attacking Tricet looks trivial, but in practice, for sure, it's very, very difficult to get practically. I think the record is 21 equals 3 times 7. So it's very far from practical realization. So this one will be even more difficult. So in theory, we could attack NP problems, but in practice, I think it might be very difficult. However, we could look at where there are successes and maybe try to improve on the currently successful superiority and maybe do it better, maybe better error correction. So this is open question. How far can we go? Can we get out of the NP problems toward p-space problems? This is open complexity problem question. Okay, so let's look at the situation. So having such the simplest situation. So here you would like to put such simple photonic chip instead inside such a ring laser. So here is such example schematic of photonic chip from my paper in this link. So it uses as state preparation, it uses the laser pulse, and then there is some creation of entangled photons. So if it uses laser pulse as state preparation, so here we put the laser pulse as positive radiation pressure, then maybe we could also use negative radiation pressure to also pull from right. So here we would like to use not only detectors, but also connect it to this ring laser for this negative radiation pressure to also influence the path information flows to such chip. Yes, so hopefully putting this chip inside such flow, you could not only push inside by positive flow, but also pull outside from with negative flow to better control the flow through such chip. Okay, so here is this similarity with hydrodynamics. So they use this vorticity. So here is zero vorticity. Here is positive vorticity. And so the magnetic field is similar to vorticity of this fluid. The lamp vector, which is vorticity cross u velocity vector, seems similar to electric field. But I think there are different also analogs. And the best experimental confirmation I know is this Zeeman, this hydrodynamical Zeeman effect. So this is very nice experiments with these bouncing droplets. If you don't know, I think you should look at this hydrodynamical analysis of quantum mechanics. So here is the, we have some rotating containment with fluid, and there is some bouncing droplet in this fluid. Enter sound, this bouncing droplet cannot just go any trajectory, but it has to be quantized, because the coupled wave has to become standing wave, as in Schrödinger's Schrödinger equation. So these are these quantized first orbit, second orbit, and then they look at two sub droplets and add this rotation in counterclockwise or clockwise, and tell sound that these quantized states are shifting, like exactly like in Zeeman effect, because the hydrodynamic analog of the Lorentz force is the Coriolis force, obtained here by this rotation of this containment. Okay, so the basic here is use of this CPT symmetry, that we believe that physics is CPT symmetric. So there is the CPT theorem by Julian Zwischwinger, that quantum field theories have to be symmetric in this way. There is this Feynman-Stackelberg interpretation that antiparticles kind of travel back in time. But the question is how to understand it. Usually it is used for microscopic setting, like single Feynman diagram. So the question is how to understand it for macroscopic setting, like we would like to apply it here. So having a macroscopic setting, we could deconstruct it, imagine deconstructing it into Feynman diagrams, apply this symmetry for order diagrams, and take them back into a CPT analog of the setting. So we can, so from one side, the fundamental equations of physics are CPT symmetric, and looking for a setting from this perspective after CPT symmetry, it should still work as in normal physics. However, we should remember that there are some asymmetries like of entropy growth from second law of thermodynamics. But we can try to work for processes which are symmetric. So we try to avoid these asymmetric processes like entropy growth. So the symmetric parts are this pull push, negative positive radiation pressure, just emission absorption. So we could try to focus on these symmetric operations, avoiding the asymmetric ones. Okay, so what about the second law of thermodynamics? My answer generally is that it is in solution, not in the equation. Like having a flat surface of lake, it is symmetric, but if we throw a rock, it becomes it breaks the symmetry in the solution. So equation is symmetric, but the solution is not symmetric. So it's not strange. And for our solution we live in, this rock was, for example, Big Bang, that everything was localized, so entropy was low, so it created the entropy gradient we see as the second law of thermodynamics. So we shouldn't think, so it is not a part of equations, but rather but just property of specific solution we live in. And for example, so the, maybe let me tell a few sentences about this. So let's look about this simple setting, these two containments with particles. But if there are classical particles, then the entropy is zero because we know everything, and there is this Poincaré recurrence theorem that it should go back to the close to original setting. So the entropy is zero. To get entropy growth, non-zero entropy, we need to apply some approximation. It's called Storch-Zelenzat kind of mean field approximation. For example, replace this deterministic setting with probability, what is probability of particle being on the left? So we replace these complex configurations with just one p, that p percentage is on the left. And doing this approximation, we can prove the entropy growth. But we need to remember that it's only approximation. Fundamentally, there is zero entropy, there is Poincaré recurrence, and there are some nice like clustering settings that we can do this kind of approximation, this Storch-Zelenzat, which allow us to prove entropy growth, but fundamentally there is symmetry in fact. So we should be careful about using these entropic arguments, because they are for effective approximation, not fundamentally we have symmetric physics. Okay, so there are the CPT symmetry analogs. So for example, in the past, it would be strange to think about optical cooling. We just can heat up with optics, optical pulling. But now we know that it's possible to cool with light, to pull with light, with tweezers. There can be prepared settings that literally pull with light. For example, solitons. Generally, the radiation pressure is a vector. So if this vector is toward the surface, then it's positive radiation pressure. And if it's outward, then you have negative radiation pressure. So it doesn't have to be positive, negative. The question is how to generate it in practice, this negative radiation pressure. And I'm arguing that the ring laser is a good tool but it has to be verified with experiments. It's a good tool to generate this negative radiation pressure for photons, for example, here. So lasers, all of them are usually believed to be governed by these two equations, simulated emission absorption. So here is for N2 is the number of excited atoms, and N1 is number of ground state atoms. So here we see that the gross number of excited atoms is absorption of photons, and here is stimulated emission, that presence of photons reduce the number of excited atoms. So they kind of pull photons from the system. And they are CPT symmetric. If we apply CPT symmetry to this picture, then they will be sweet side, the two equations. So they are symmetric, and so this is an argument that this B12 should be equal to B21, what is well known, that these two coefficients there. And there is also asymmetric part. This is spontaneous emission, and spontaneous emission has to be asymmetric because it is easy for photons created to fly away toward future, but to get back from the past, you need to assault in the past, but what is not usually obtained. So it is easy to escape to our future, but difficult to get these photons from the past. So spontaneous emission is asymmetric. But we can focus here on this stimulated emission absorption, which is CPT symmetric. And now looking at this setting for ring laser, so it uses optical isolator, which is kind of diode for photons. I will say in a moment how it works. So it enforces that photons go in one direction, but looking from CPT symmetric, then you'd reverse the photon trajectory, so you'd get this violet trajectory. So from the CPT perspective, where physics should work the same, we see that these photons should create positive pressure in this direction. What in the original setting means that it should create negative pressure in this direction. So it does not only make the positive pressure here, but also the ignored target should have negative radiation pressure. What means these equations should act on it. What is very non-trivial, because to make it work, we need non-zero N2, that we need to initially excite this target. So to observe it, we need to excite this target. It vanishes. This term vanishes if there are only ground state atoms. So it's not trivial to observe it. You would need to, let's say, additionally pump this target with some external pump. So this is one type of arguments that it should have both positive and negative. That means that looking at these two equations, so we know that both equations act on the internal target of this target. And we also know that laser creates these photons, so that they are absorbed. So this equation also acts on this target. It should be also symmetrically that these equations also are on this target. And another argument for that is that we could add this detour, that a few mirrors to make also light go around. And adding this detour, we make these external targets internal targets. So now they are inside this flow of photons, so both equations should act. So now adding the detour, additionally, that this equation should be added to this target, and now both equations should act on this target, but the detour has only one of them. So one equation should be before the detour. There are some arguments that this equation already act on this target, external target. So we should be able not only cause excitation of external target, but also cause the excitation of external target from the second side. So it should act as pump for photons. Okay, so here are some different settings. So here is the Faraday effect I've mentioned. So it uses these materials which rotates the linear polarization by some fixed angle. So if putting some linear polarizers in the beginning and after, then only photons in one direction are allowed, and the second are not allowed. Using this symmetry, the photon trajectory would be reversed, but also this material has to be break the time symmetry, because it uses difference of propagation speed of one circular polarization the second. So after T symmetry, the, these two polarization change are replaced. So this material has to violate the time symmetry. Okay, so here are some different settings, different ways to achieve it. One is, for example, the free electron laser, that we have photons, electrons creating this beam of photons, and from CPT symmetry, we just replace electrons with positrons and traveling in the opposite direction. So if it was pushing photons ordinarily, so it should be also pulling photons from the opposite direction. And I wanted to originally to test it with in synchrotron and Solaris in Krakow, but by putting, so they are these segments, and we could put some lamp behind and test if the presence of this free electron laser would pull some photons, so should speed up the excitation. And it could be observed, for example, you have a lamp and check. And so if there are more photons pulled here, then the detectors around this lamp should see a smaller intensity of light. So it could be tested. And finally, I think this ring laser is the most practical. So depending on the frequencies, I think it will be also useful for different settings in future. Okay, so how to test it experimentally? I'm looking for a collaboration. If you know somebody, I'll gladly discuss. So the question is, if this equation acts on the external target, it's suggested by the CPT symmetry, by the DTOR, adding one equation, why there should be two equations becoming internal target. So there are a few ways to test it. So I have put in the article these two hypotheses. Hypothesis one is that CPT symmetry is true for macroscopic objects. That means if it would be absorbed in CPT perspective, so if you reverse trajectory, then the simulation equation should also act here. And the alternative hypothesis is that we have only absorption, that we can only excite outside the laser. So the question is, which one is true, this CPT or this absorption only hypothesis? And here are some few ways to test it experimentally. So one is continuously excite this target on the left and check if the laser opening the shutter, for example, here. Make it faster the excite, lose the excited atoms. Another way is that for standard laser, both equations should in fact act on external targets. So what would prevent, make it impossible to get the population inversion with shooting with laser and onto two-stream system. It is believed, it is not practical, but if this HCPT is true, then we should be able to get higher population with ring laser than standard laser. So it can be tested. So if you know somebody, I would gladly collaborate and then to test it finally. But even if it doesn't work, still we can put it and make them internal such photonic chip an internal target, and still they should be both. Both these equations should act on it, so it should work as both pushing photons inside and pulling photons outside with the two equations. So still, even if this absorption logic hypothesis is true, then we should still be able to put it inside as a chip for these two-way quantum computers. Okay, so finally we have the situation we would like to put as here at the chip. Here is such example of chip. So looking from T symmetric would switch the two boundary conditions and inverse the unitary evolution. I believe it should work. So obviously there are lots of technologies for quantum computers, some ions, trapped ions, some called atoms, neutral atoms, some superconductors with oscillation modes, some quantum silicon quantum dots, impurity in diamonds, then maybe topological, and finally photonics. And so the question is, for each of them, we could try to think about reversing the process used for state preparation and trying to realize this reverse process, like push-pull, like absorption emission. Like if you can, with absorption, you can get excited state as the initial state. We can get with emission, with the second equation, should be able to get ground state as the final state. So this is open question, how to get it for various technology. Can we do it? So here are some variable technologies with the number of qubits. And there are also mechanical qubits. In the recent years, like resonators, they create that I can work as qubits. So it becomes also for superfluid. So also this microfluidic superfluid pump, maybe still in some future can be used to realize a quantum computer where we could literally pull with pump to better control the flow of flow through such chip. So I believe it's a matter of time to get two-way quantum computers, which in theory are more powerful. Okay, so for topological quantum computers, we can see that this is very time symmetric. So we have some initial final state, and this is very time symmetric. So they are saying that finally they measure by annihilating inside. So here we can see that they are annihilated inside, but we can also try to annihilate them with a chosen one. So then we need to control the final value, not only observe, but also try to enforce it. Like in two-way quantum computers, try to control not only the state preparation, but also the final state through some active action. Okay, so here is the final slide. So final work and collaboration. I'm really looking for a collaboration. So there are lots of open questions. So for example, various technologies. So could we look at the state preparation used for them and try to reverse this process and try to apply to the final state to try to influence it and force it? Then imperfections, error correction. For example, so instead of perfect zero as the final state, in practice could be some epsilon, some mixture of two states, and then we can use some error correction, like some taking some multiple physical states as one physical qubits as one logical qubits. Then we can maybe we could there are problems error correction. Maybe we could use this pooling to stabilize the flow to get better error correction. And then different approaches than this basic one of just restricting the ensemble to satisfying our problem. Maybe, for example, you could reverse the unitary calculation. You can take this unitary part and make it literally reversed and try to play with that. Maybe then it would allow for some nice possibilities. But the question is, what to do if measure? The measure is only related from the future. Can we do something like CPT analog of measurement? I don't know. It looks very, very strange, but maybe it's enough to use standard measurement. Then I think the very promising direction is looking at what people get, the superiority claims, and try to improve of them by adding this additional operation, this CPT analog of state preparation, to maybe to stabilize the process, to get better error correction, to get some new possibilities, better algorithms, better superiority. Then finally, if being optimistic that it will occur NP problems, so the which NP problems for which tasks? This is a very general optimization question, a very difficult question, and a new complexity classes. So if BQP goes outside NP, everything is in P space. But the question is, where exactly in P space? Can you go even farther than standard BQP? That's an open question. For example, we have imagine you have this state prepared as all the satisfying our some verifier and can we work on that? What's happening? So can we work on this ensemble to get something better? So we have this, imagine we have such ensemble. Could we operate on it, for example, to try to go toward P space, like adding this for all quantifier. So this is very, very interesting open question. How far can we go with this additional operation? Finally, if maybe in some future NP problems could be endangered with some better computation, maybe it's worth to work on P space based cryptography, some using more complex problems than NP. So this is a very interesting question. Can we use P-space problem for cryptography? I'm thinking about it, and it's quite difficult, but maybe it's doable. And finally, there are the tests for these basic photonic questions, and maybe thinking about different applications of this RCPT anacoustic preparation. Okay, thank you. So let me turn off the recording. Where is the recording? Stop recording.